Next up, we have Olivier Royan, Editor-in-Chief of Paris Match, whose presentation is entitled New Journalism, Print, Digital, and Motion Design. The media industry in general, and the print media in particular, are having their business models disrupted. Olivier will share his story of how Paris Match is making the transition into the digital era, whilst keeping in mind that storytelling and brand remain as important today as they did at the launch of Paris Match back in 1949. I note from his bio that Olivier has a strong political and business background by way of education. He's had a journalistic career that has included the publication of a book entitled September the 11th, 2001, The War, An Investigation on the Attack on Humanity. He was also the White House correspondent during the Clinton presidency. Since becoming editor-in-chief of Paris Match has twice won the French Magazine of the Year award. In what might be a warning to politicians, Paris Match demonstrated the power of the media after the Haiti earthquake when it rebuilt a thousand student school in Port-au-Prince just 12 months after the disaster. On a personal note, Olivier is married with two children and likes to sail and ski. So, with cowbells at the ready, let's make a big noise for Olivier.
What's our first slide? That's the one. Bonjour, good morning. I'm very honored and very humbled to be with you today. Actually, I wonder why they asked me to address such an outstanding audience. I come from the old world. I didn't invent anything. As AD said, I'm just a journalist. I run an old school French media star. 60 years after its creation, Paris Match remains the most read magazine in France. It is sold in 120 countries. And we received last year the award of Magazine of the Year. We are all well and alive like this happy dinosaur. I am actually a happy and a passionate editor. Nevertheless, everywhere I turn, I see threatening clouds. Technology redefined the news business. Thanks to technology and social networks, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, we are reaching far more people than before. A lot of new profiles and not so much profit, actually. But sometimes internet and technology have endangered the quality of journalism. The web has been a magnet for superficiality, rumors, ideological bias. We have become live news organization. We cover events as they happen. The world of journalism is changing faster than ever. And the information is perceived by consumers as a free commodity, which is a tendency that Pepe could add to his presentation, which doesn't sound too good for a journalist. We journalists have to reinvent ourselves without compromising our principles. Sometimes as a carbon-based editor, magazine editor, I must confess that I feel like the little guy on the lighthouse, surrounded by a storm. What future follows? How foster a culture of innovation within our media companies? And how can we develop a digital new journalism? Before giving you some answers to these questions based on our experience, I'm going to be a little provocative. I've come today to Luxembourg to tell you that I believe in the power of print. I believe that in the impact of news photo, and I'm convinced that even as a weekly magazine, we can still surprise our readers. We live, yes, multi-platform lives, and that includes print. When I see people reading magazines, I can see them enjoying the experience because it's so convenient and it's so personal. Reading a magazine starts with a touchy feeling sensation. It's a sensual experience, and nothing has replaced this experience so far. The other day, I met with a charismatic, young, startup, new media entrepreneur, and I told him, I want to be like you. You created this new company. I envy your double-digit growth number. You have a bunch of algorithms that allow you at any time to measure the buzz on the web. You have this capability to deliver to your audience exactly what they want to read at the precise moment and have them participate in the process of gathering and sharing the news. These new technologies actually have opened enormous opportunities for the journalists. And you know, I was surprised by his answers. He said, no, you don't get it. I would love to be like you. You have a solid brand known by 92% of the French population. You have an iconic institution in your hands. You have millions of customers. You pay you each week a fair amount of money for the unique experience you offer them. They trust you. You have 12 million photos in your archives. And most of all, you have a staff of 100 experienced journalists. That's a treasure you can build on and develop. This dialogue between these two persons coming from two different universes tells a lot about this present moment that we live in, where journalism meets technology. Should I say meet or should I say clash? Should I say synergy or collision? Some months ago, I was my attention was captured by this by an article in Wire magazine, written by Stephen Levy. The title was promising: "The Robot Reporter. Can algorithms write a better news story than our human reporters?" First, I almost collapsed. But soon I found out that computer-written articles already run on websites and respected publications like Forbes, as well as other media internet powers, many of which are keeping their identity private. Robot reporting, robot writing the news, that's the incredible power of technology and innovation. After all, recently, with the use of drones, military have proved and managed to wage a war at distance to reduce their loss. But there is not such a thing as a journalistic drone. The photographers on the field, they risk it all to be our eyes in the darkness, and we rely on them. Take a look at these guys, Remy Oschlick. He was 28, a promising talent at Paris Match. Like others in the young generation of photojournalism, he decided to cross the Mediterranean Sea to cover the Arab Springs. On February the 23rd, Second, he sent us his last photo from Homs in Syria at midnight. He was killed 6 hours later with his colleague, Marie Colvin. I do agree with what Tim Errington was saying. If we weren't there filming, reporting there, then it didn't happen. This kind of journalism requires a total engagement. I give you an example. 5 weeks ago, we published this investigative reporter. It took us 5 months and three different trips to Lebanon and Syria for our reporter to gather the facts and pieces of evidence that show clearly the use of chemical weapons against the populations. 3 weeks after the publication of this story, along with another in the British press, the United Nations have finally issued a resolution condemning the use of by the government of Bashar al-Assad of chemical weapons against civilian populations. That's where lies the incredible importance of journalism, of quality journalism today. Quality journalism says things that powerful don't want to hear. Before I mention some paths we are exploring at Paris Match to bridge journalism and technology, let me say a word about the magazine. When somebody picks up an issue of Time magazine, of the Financial Times, of Stern, The Guardian, of Paris Match, this act is very important. It demonstrates its trust in the professionalism associated with the brand. In France, if you say Paris Match, everybody will answer you, le poids des mots, le choc des photos, the power of words, the shock of pictures. Everyone knows what we stand for. This is our DNA, our value proposition to our customers. We must be clear and distinct. This is true for all media today. Don't try to be somebody else. Go deeper in your own tradition. Protect your particularity and protect your values. There is no brand extension without a strong brand in the first place. If we want to be in one of the last bubble presented by Pepe, we have to be strong in the first place in our brands. Take a look, that was Paris Match in 1949. This is our first team, and that's Paris Match 60 years later, the fourth generation of reporters. They went to Greenland to document the melting of the Arctic ice. They painted the logo actually near this iceberg with the bio painting. What can they have in common with the first crew? That's field journalism. It's our passion, it's in our blood, it's our genes, and we can help ourselves. And we want to offer the public a unique experience based on quality information, emotion, and surprise. Knowing your audience, I think it's a key element in our industry today. It's the initial condition to create this community, create a vision for our community. We have to remain always on the reader's side. We have to find the truth behind the bullshit, dig deeper, expose wrongdoing, expose corruptions. The other things, we are storyteller. Paris Match is one of the few magazines in the world that can be many things at the same time. We issue part serious book, part glamour, part entertainment, part art news. It's life as it is, and our readers expect that kind of unique mix. It's a story of the world, the human experience. That's what we do. I'll give you an example. That's a story taken in August 2012 in Syria. Our photographer captured the true moment at midnight, a wedding under the bombs between a nurse and a Syrian Liberation Army member. Another example, do you remember? That was the double page as it appeared in Paris Match. Another example, do you remember this young lady? She appeared on 55 covers of magazine and hundreds of daily newspapers. She went all over the internet. But nobody knew her name. Nobody knew why she was standing like this anyway. The whole world published the picture without knowing her story. It took us 2 months, but we found her in a refugee camp. And that morning, we can now say that Yuko was witnessing the rescue of her missing son. We invited her to Paris, actually some months later, to tell us her story. So for us, it's behind the scene, it's behind the curtains, it's behind the lines. And people expect from us private moment, backstage moment. And when we publish exclusive stories, our readers are being given something very special. They get behind the doors. We also believe that pictures can change the world. It's important to be a witness to make images that communicate human suffering and send them to the world. And we believe that in this time of instant communication, that still picture can capture the heart and mind of the moment. Do you remember that one? The Pulitzer Prize by Nick Hutt, and probably you remember that. These are the images that made the international community to act and understand the magnitude of the human catastrophe that was last. That was in September at the Visa pour l'Image Festival for Photojournalism in Perpignan. The photographer Stéphanie Sinclair represented 10 years of work, 10 years of her life, working on the suffering of these young girls who are forced to marry at a young age. Today, the United Nations and some NGOs are trying to change the situation. Today, in our environment, particularly in the media, the brand that provides an element of recognition is a start. But brand recognition doesn't mean brand adoptions. The mothers and grandmothers of France may love Paris Match, but their young sons and grandsons know the brand, they know Paris Match, but doesn't necessarily use it or feel they need it. The other day, traveling in Paris, we asked a young and sympathetic taxi driver, that's not always the case in Paris, and we asked him, do you know Paris Match? The driver said, no, not really, it's my mother magazine. Then we show him a better version of our new Paris Match mobile application we're working on. It's full of motions, colors, video, and ask, what do you think of that? His reaction was interesting. Suddenly the driver was pretty excited. He said, wow, it's so genuine. I would read that. Clearly the sons and grandsons are not necessarily reading ink on paper. They are into mobile device, as Pepe said also. It creates a fantastic opportunity for us to reach a new public, and that's what I want to talk to you today. But we have to keep in mind that when we try to bring the brand of Paris Match and this Paris Match experience to new audiences, we have to find ways to build new storytelling experiences, being able to deploy these new storytelling experiences across our different platforms. And this is an essential evolution in quality journalism. Failure would precipitate our decline. Storytelling. How can one take the brand to the non-user? It's all about stories, of course. As journalists, we have to concentrate on what we do best, telling human stories, constantly seeking the truth with all the means at our disposal. This exercise of journalism is not perfect, but it helps to sustain democracy. At this point, I would like to show you a little film. Sorry, it's in French, but you'll get the spirit of it. It's a sort of pre-summer refreshing for us. You can't reinvent Paris Match, Yet the world is changing, and with it, the eyes and the expectations of our readers and of our journalists. This is why we have decided to redesign our layout, making it more dynamic, enhancing the match experience, and then with new narrative formats to mirror our evolving world. Special consideration has been given to introducing a good balance of longer narrative pieces with shorter finger-reading materials, because in our world, people sometimes start reading with their fingers before they read with their eyes. Let me give you an example. Well, this little film shows that technology and innovation can help a great deal in developing the new narrative format that helps us to reach and monetize our new audiences. Pepe was mentioning the question of data. Data is absolutely a fascinating new field for journalism. In our newly redesigned magazine, we feature a graphic-driven new data page. Data journalists are part of a very small group these days. Actually, most of them are still in school. But data is a new language of journalism based on technology. It's clever, fun, provocative, and inspirational. And I think it contributes to a more open society and more open journalists. The activist being shown on the cover of Time magazine this week, Ed Snowden and Assange, of course, could be data journalists because they release all this data. Our new section, Match Avenir, is using motion design, is using video. And I think this is very important for us also to point out that today in the newsroom, the keywords is collaborative. 5 years ago, and even 10 years ago, Eddie would say it also, the news story was suddenly assembled by a journalist, a reporter, and a photographer. They were working as a team. Today, new talents are joining the journalistic process. The story is now the product of not only journalists, but also graphic designers, developers, data journalists, IT people. This input of new skills make possible the development of exciting new pieces of journalism, including 3D, motion design, and data. So I would say today, as my point of view, is that bridging the gap between print and digital is the ultimate challenge for editors, and it will continue to be for at least 10 more years. Engage the audience, create the interaction, as Pepe was saying. This is where the media quartet concept comes to play. The four pillars of a media brand these days are the print, the web, the tablet, the mobile, four different experiences. That's me on the photos. And you don't tell a story the same way on these four different platforms. And that's where the editors and the journalists have to reinvent themselves. These are four different experiences that have to be thought and designed with their own form of visual narrative. One of the paradoxes these days is the more you feature small pieces in the magazine, the more you need to feature long pieces. There is an appetite for long-form journalism, and even one of the founder of Facebook bought a magazine these days. The notion that the story has a beginning and an ending conclusion is changing. Magazines have always been good at capturing readers' preference and feelings, and magazine writers, for example, in the early 70s, they were quick to adopt first-person accounts to rejuvenate journalism. It allowed powerful narrative. Today, digital media needs to invent its own journalistic storytelling formats. Last week, covering the World Congress of Newspaper in Bangkok, my colleague Frederic Filiou from Les Echos noted that Latin American and Asia publishers were taking advantage of their healthy print business to accelerate the online transition. These many simultaneous changing we just mentioned required within our newsroom many transformation, and this really make the journalists feel a little worried these days, because in these new structures, journalists, multimedia producers, developers are blending together. As a conclusion, I would say it's not digital first or print first. It's the story first, and how you can capture moments of the story and present them through various platforms. The condition of this transition, if we want to succeed this transition, is to gather superb journalistic skills. At Paris Match and elsewhere, the new media depends very much on the old media. I stated at the beginning that I was a strong supporter of print journalism, but at the same time, we have new exciting tools, and these are exciting times to be a journalist and to create new genre. To finish, I would like to show you a little film. Pepe was mentioning that the world is becoming mobile device dependent. In the media, 20 to 40% of pages viewed already come from my platform. The secret to success in mobile platform relies on how we can present an original experiences to our readers. So this disrupts the newsroom. I show you what we're working for this day, what we're working on. It's a little film we work together. We work with Mario Garcia, a magazine maker. So that's the way we enter the new world, coming from the old world. It's a lot of work. You have to reinvent ourselves, and it's a lot of disruption within the newsroom. But we are doing it, and that's why we started with this little Pink Panther music. It's because it's a Parisian story, and Paris is in our name. Thank you very much.